we're going to have to do this without audio or with just laptop audio, which is kind of funny, but that's what we have to do. So anyway, so I'm Andrew Schloss, and I teach in Victoria, but I live in Seattle, kind of. And Randy got a master's over there, so I don't know how many of you know that, but... And one thread that's kind of interesting is Randy's sound playing is derived from this thing, which I'll talk about. I don't know what everyone's background is, but I assume you're all into computers and music, or you wouldn't be sitting here. So I'm going to start with a tiny bit of history. I started using computers in the late 60s. I'm a couple of years older than Bill Gates, but I think it was similar. There was a teletype when he was a high school student here. What our computer was connected to was Dartmouth, and they ran BASIC. You could type on a teletype. Are you guys old enough to remember that? So I learned BASIC in the late 60s. And then I went to Bennington, which is big in music, and Joel Chattaby was there. Some of you probably know who he is. But we had a Moog synthesizer, just in the early 70s, and it was great. It was a new thing for me. But the thing that was frustrating that kind of led me to where I am now in a way is that we had these things called sequencers, which were just kind of ways of sequencing voltages. And in general, it was really hard to replicate things and make things repeat and just sort of generally do something you could do again the next day. Partly because the oscillators and so on are, you know, they're not exact like digital oscillators. So I loved the Moog. It's a Moog on the East Coast. But I really thought it would be great to hook up a computer to it. And in fact, that was big for a while. There were these hybrid systems with analog synthesis and computer control. Anyway, so I kind of stopped doing electronic music for a while because I was frustrated with analog electronics. So then I ended up going to New York and working as a professional musician in experimental theater and stuff like that. And I did a show on Broadway. And I did a whole bunch of performing in New York, which was great because, as you all know, if you do computer music, you spend way more time staring at screens. It's very hard to avoid that problem. And I say problem just because if you're a musician, how come you're not playing music? But I think there is a tendency for us to kind of get, you know, develop as much complexity as we possibly can. So we stare at the laptop and we don't make sound or we don't play live. So I was working as a musician, playing every day, and it was great. But I wanted to do something having to do with computers. So I went to a bookstore in Manhattan in around 1976, I would say, and I said, "Do you have any information about computer music?" And they said, "You know, we have nothing." And they, "But no, wait," they said, "we have some kind of magazine here, and we have Volume 1, Number 1, published by the People's Computer Company." And it was the Computer Music Journal, the first one. It came out in 76. I looked at it, I couldn't understand a single word of it. And I looked at the people who wrote it, and it was Andy Moore, John Gray, John Snell, John Chowning. Everybody, and the whole issue was from Stanford. And being in my early 20s, I just said, well, I'm going to go to Stanford. I didn't think, gee, how am I going to get in or anything. I just said, I'm going to Stanford. And I did. I spent 7 years at Stanford. Those were the days when you could do stuff like that. We all had big grants, and because I was part of the AI lab. And skip that for now. This is just an example of the kind of people that show up at the AI lab. And this is a little later, but we have Leon Thurman, who came from Russia because he was discovered by Paul Lansky, who was at Princeton. The author of CMix and other things. And Lansky thought Thurman was dead. Everyone thought he was dead. And so they brought him back. This is for the 100th anniversary of Stanford University, which I think was in 1991 or so. And I did a concert with David Jaffe, I don't have a cursor, but you can see the names. David Jaffe in the purple shirt, who's a composer, lives in Berkeley, also works at Universal Audio, is equally good as a performer, composer, and programmer. Anyway, you can see Don Buchla there, David Wessel, Bob Moog, I mean everybody, Dave Smith, Tom Oberheim, Roger Lynn, it's kind of amazing. And of course, Max Mathews, the father of computer music. And so these are the influences, Max Mathews, Bob Boie, who were at Bell Labs before Max came out to Stanford. He was at Bell Labs. And Trippin lives here in Seattle. I'm going to talk a bit about him, too. And Kamala Nankara lived in Mexico City and did sort of the most amazing sort of computer music, even though he didn't use computers, by typing or punching holes in player piano rolls. How many people know about Kamala Nankara? Just a tiny bit. So Kamala Nankara is really important because he inspired so many people, especially Trippin. You all know about Trippin. He lives here. So now Max Mathews, the guy who first made music with a computer in 1950-something at Bell Labs, it was obvious that AT&T wanted to get as many streams of data through one wire, and you can do that a lot better. And they saw that digital transmission and communication was the way to go. So they were studying signal processing, and for example, the great genius Claude Shannon figured out exactly what the parameters were, because nobody actually knew Claude Shannon's famous theorem, which is called the Nyquist theorem. It should be called the Shannon-Nyquist theorem. It says that to represent signals with a bandwidth of n, you have to sample at 2n. Or for whose highest frequency is n, you have to sample at 2n. What's amazing about it is that it's exactly correct. You can, that's it. End of story. And it's not that hard to prove, but that was Claude Shannon's master's thesis, I think, at MIT before he went to Bell Labs. And that really changed everything. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is that a signal is a signal. So they're working on conversations, of course, but why not do music? So Max Mathews' boss at the time was John Pierce, who is famous for two things. Famous for being the father of satellite communications, and also famous for going into Shakti's lab, who showed him this thing. He said, "What should I call it?" And Pierce said, "Well, there's a resistor. How about a transistor?" Mm-hmm. So it was John Pierce who named the transistor. So anyway, Pierce was quite a good musician, and he ended up at Stanford too after basically everybody fled Bell Labs after the U.S. government clobbered them with their monopoly antitrust or whatever you call it. And so Bell Labs started to fall apart and people left, and Mathews and Pierce both went to Stanford. Anyway, so after being in New York for a while, I went to the lab, and this is the Moog that I had at Bennington after I graduated from high school, and this is the AI lab where I went after 4 years of wandering around New York and other places. This is the machine room at the AI lab, and what's interesting about the history of computer music is that basically it goes back to Bell Labs, Stanford, MIT, and IRCOM to some extent. IRCOM was the lab in Paris that Pierre Boulez started, but actually we called IRCOM Karma Sorsen, because IRCOM ran all of our software, mostly written by Andy Moore, who's a brilliant programmer. Anyway, a machine room, those of you again who are old enough to remember, these were all refrigerated. The floor down there was 2 feet, above the actual floor, and it had ventilation running underneath it and cables. And it's unbelievable, I don't have to tell all of you digital types here, exactly how many millions or billions of times faster and more memory we have now, even in a phone. This was a 36-bit architecture of the PDB-10. These giant blue cabinets maybe had, if they were memory, they maybe had 16K of memory or something like that. It was unbelievable. What's interesting is one of the geniuses at the AI lab invented another computer. Actually, he got in a fight with DEC because he actually designed the operating system or something for the PDB-10. And he got in a fight with them, and they somehow settled it, and he started his own computer company called Foonly, which is based on Foo, which is based on fucked up beyond all recognition, Foobar. So Foo was like a computer word that you would use if you named a file, you'd call it Foo. So he called it Foonly, which was an inside joke. And he built a 36-bit architecture, really cheap version of the PDP-10 that no one's heard of, because I think the only ones that existed were the ones at the AI lab and the ones at Intelligenetics and some of the other companies in Silicon Valley that wanted to hire programmers from the AI lab. And they all knew SAIL, and they all wanted to work on a PDP-10. So he sold a bunch of Foonlys around town. I think there's probably a Foonly at the museum. You know that museum in Anyway, so now here's what's interesting, for me personally at least, is that I ended up at the AI lab and I knew nothing. How could someone who knew nothing get into the AI lab? Well, you had to be clever, or at least creative. So I was a musician. I mean, I knew, you know, I didn't know nothing, but I certainly didn't know anything about computers. I took one programming course, official course, actually here at UW, where I spent a little bit of time before I went down there. And I spent an entire semester with punch cards in Fortran, you know, trying to find the roots of a quadratic. I mean, it was a waste of time. It was tedious, and I just fled from UW. Now, UW is way better now than they were then, but in the 70s, their computer science department was kind of in the Stone Age. Of course, everyone was in the Stone Age. But not Stanford. So I went down there, and I figured out a way to become a student there through a psychoacoustics laboratory. There were people in at CARMA, that stands for the Center for Computer Research and Music and Acoustics. There were people there who were doing psychoacoustics research that, in fact, many people thought it was insane. Like, why would you do this? And it's funny, because just as an example, masking experiments, where you play one sound and see if it covers another sound, it sounds boring, but guess what? That's what MP3 files are. So that turned into a $1 billion business. But nobody in the 70s or the 80s had any idea that masking experiments would be of any use other than just because, you know, we're curious. Anyway, the AI lab was run by McCarthy, John McCarthy, who wrote Lisp. So people programmed in Lisp, but they also programmed in Sail. Sail was a dialect of Algol, but it had millions and millions of special, and it was the opposite of C. It was just gigantic. Anyway, so this is me and David and Max Mathews experimenting with the radio drum. The radio drum has gone through a lot of versions since it came out. So let me just quickly, pretty much nobody really knows the history of the thing. What happened was Bob Boie is a robotics engineer at Bell Labs, and he was interested in capacitive sensing, and he built capacitive sensing screens way back, like in the late 70s or in the 80s. And AT&T had no idea what to do with them. And in fact, it's funny because Apple was sued about maybe 15 years ago for stealing the touchscreen idea, and they just called Boie up, and he didn't want to, but they made him testify, I guess. And I don't know how you do that, but they did. He testified and he said, "Look, I did all this work, you know, 30, 40 years ago." So he was no fan of Apple's, but he was able to show that nobody copied Apple because Boie had done all this way before. So the idea of capacitive sensing is pretty old. And so what Boie did, in addition to a million different kind of funny experiments that he had all kinds of things that were so far ahead of their time that they never were products. Like he had a clipboard you could write on and it would digitize it and stuff, which now, you know. But he also thought about, you know, capacitance is most accurate on the surface. But you can get a capacitive field, you know, maybe like this high. And so he tried to make a three-dimensional mouse, and it failed as a mouse. But since John Pierce and Max Mathews were both interested in music, they thought, well, maybe we can make a musical instrument out of it. And it started out as a sort of a hybrid between a conducting device and a percussion device. That's why it used to be called the radio baton or the radio drum or something like that. And there were a bunch of different versions of it. I don't have pictures of all the versions. But I will say that a funny thing happened last year at the New York History Museum or something. There's a museum in New York dedicated to the history of New York City, which is pretty cool. I haven't been there, but I've looked at their stuff. And they called me up because they wanted to find some of Max Mathews' original work. And one of the things they wanted was a radio drum from the early days. And they couldn't find one. And Max had died by then. They found his widow in Palo Alto, and she didn't have any. But of course, I never throw anything away. Nobody knows that, and I don't throw anything away, including files. But so I had three of them. So they sent these people who are used to packing up Picassos and, you know, and Renoirs with their white gloves and their giant stuff, and they took this antenna, which is you could drive a truck over probably, and they probably spent, I don't know how many thousands of dollars, but anyway, I shipped it to New York and they put it on display last year. This down here, I can't point, but is an antenna. It has sort of a backgammon pattern on it, And it picks up a signal from the sticks, which are transmitting at around 120 kilohertz. And that's why they call it a radio drum. So the two sticks transmit at different frequencies. And then under here is this backgammon pattern, or just a wedge pattern that makes it possible to sort of triangulate to find out where the sticks are. The easiest thing to do is figure out how far away they are, because the strength of the signal obviously gets weaker as you get further. But you can also figure out where you are in X and Y, although the accuracy of X and Y, which I'll show, actually show you now, I think. Randy wrote this. Remember this, Randy? So here you see on the surface, I can trace, you know, I can go sort of underneath there. And, but as I go up, let's say I'm in the corner here, as I go up, the signal gets, you get to the point where you can't figure out where you are in X and Y. That's, and that only, I don't think there's any way around that with capacitive sensing. So the good thing about capacitive sensing is that it's super accurate on the surface. You can sample at any sampling rate you want. It's good for stuff I do. But it's not good in the sense that if you start here and go straight up, the ball moves to the center. It's like an inverted bowl. So anyway, they were trying to figure out what to do with it, and they decided to try to make a drum. The first drum was had an antenna, something like that. That's not the very first one. It looked like a tea tray. It had white formica over it, and it had a black box that it connected to that was running RS-232. So by that time, I had finished my degree at Stanford in 1985, and I got my first job. I had no idea what I was going to do for a living, because who did? I didn't worry about it. That's the difference. Now everyone's panicking. I mean, young people. So I just figured out something will come up, and something did come up. I got a job at Brown University, which is actually not a bad place. And I taught at Brown for 4 years, and it was near Bell Labs. So I drove down to Bell Labs, and I introduced myself to Max and Boie, and I said, you know, I'm a drummer. Show me this thing. So they showed me a really crude thing with two pages of C code, and they said, look, you can tell which stick it is. And I said, well, that's stupid. Why would you want to know which stick it is? Drums don't know which stick it is. That shows you how naive I was. Turns out to be incredibly powerful to know which stick is which. The fact that a drum doesn't know that doesn't mean you can't use it. So anyway, they gave me one to take back to Brown, and I started playing with it, but I'm not really a great programmer, and I was trying to make it do something, but it's very tedious writing code in C, unless you're, you know, an expert. It takes a long time. So luckily, I got a grant to go to IRCOM, where David Wessel was before he went to Berkeley to start SynMap. And David Wessel invited me over there, and I went over with the drum, because, you know, I don't know if you know, Wessel was a drummer, too. Not widely known, but that's how he started. And I met this guy named Miller Puckett, who's a brilliant programmer, and he had a language called Patcher, which now is called Max MSP. But back in the 80s, Miller was sick and tired of composers who didn't know how to program, and they would get these technologists to write their code for them. By the way, this is a really interesting cultural difference between Europe, and especially France, and the US. That is to say, in Europe, and in France particularly, I'm the great artist. Would you please plug that in over there? You know, it's like this kind of annoying for Americans. It's kind of like, I'm the artist, you're the technologist. And it pissed off the people who worked there, like Kurt Lippi and Zach Settle and other, because they were composers, but they happened to know how to program, and they knew something about audio. And the composers didn't really know anything. And so they got in a lot of fights. But one of the things that happened to Miller was that they'd be rehearsing at IRCOM with the ensemble Intercontemporain, and they would have some parameter that was wrong. They'd have to call him up. He'd have to come in on the metro or something and change a number in this stupid program and then recompile it. And he decided, this is insane. So he decided to write an interpreted language that was graphical, that musicians could understand. And so he wrote Patcher. And Patcher looks like this. And it's a graphical programming language. It has hierarchical subroutines or whatever you want to call it, where you double-click on it and you get another thing, and this is a data structure. And so, anyway, it's a programming language written in C, but it's an object-oriented graphical language, and it's really fast. So Miller wrote max, and then what you could do is if you didn't like a value, you could just change it like I'm doing now. Now that might sound ridiculous, but you know, you couldn't do that with these programs before. You could not just change a parameter, especially in real time. So if the processing that Boulez was doing on the clarinet was too loud or too shrill, even a composer could be taught how to change the parameters. And of course, the programmer can easily decide ahead of time which of these parameters need to be changed. Now, you can do that in C also. The problem is that once you compile it, you can't, you know, do anything else to it. And then you need to be a programmer. Anyway, so he wrote Patcher, and Miller likes beer. So I got him some beer, and I said, look, I've got these two pages of C code. Can you make an external, which is basically wrapping a C program and making it an object in this language? So he said, okay. So I gave him some beers, and he wrote an external object. It took him, you know, maybe an hour. And then he gave it to me, and then suddenly I realized this is not just a way of talking to the drum, because it was RS-232 into a serial port of the Mac at the time at some low baud rate. But the point is that these numbers that were coming in, it wasn't just that I could talk to the drum. I suddenly had a language that I can interpret the numbers. So for example, you know, you can see these three dimensions, X, Y, and Z, visually, and that takes 2 seconds to hook up. You just you know, grab one of these sliders and connect it, and that's it. Now, of course, showing this to you in 2016 isn't so impressive because there's lots of languages that do something like this. But I can tell you, in 1987, nothing was anything like this. I mean, there was C sound and C music, C sound from MIT from Barry Virko, and C music from Dick Moore at UCSD, and that was it. And you had to know how to program, and you had to compile it. It was very slow. So this was a revelation, and it ran on a Macintosh. Now, it didn't make sound. I should point out that the original version of Max, Patcher, as it was called, didn't have any ability to make sound because computers were too slow. But they could control synthesizers, so that's what we did. When MIDI came out in 1982 or so, we started connecting small Macintosh computers with MIDI synthesizers, and I'm sure you know all about that. But that was what allowed us to do all kinds of clever programming. There was also a program called MIDI Lisp, which was really, really great. It was from Earcom, and Wessel was always, every time he went to a conference, people would attack him and ask him for copies of MIDI Lisp, and Boulez didn't let him, wasn't supposed to give it away, but he gave it away anyway. And MIDI Lisp was really cool. I don't think there's anything, I think it's pretty much died. So that's what got me started programming in Max. And so, let me go back to the story. And when I was at Earcom, this is actually at Banff, but I started really trying to turn this into a real instrument. And here's where I started getting in fights with Max Mathews, because Max is a brilliant, was a brilliant guy, really wonderful person, but his philosophy of life was, and it worked really well for him, it's like, it works for me. Mm-hmm. And so when I tried to get him to change things, he just, you know, he wasn't motivated. So I had to do it myself. So I never actually built my own drum, but I kept modifying it. I found this foam at the Béache Bay in Paris. This is some kind of furniture foam, but it's really hard to find this stuff. And I got, you know, I tried to make it into an instrument. Now, obviously, it's a virtual instrument, and it doesn't make any sound on its own. So you either have to trigger samples or synthesize sound, or what I've been doing with Trimpin, which is to play acoustic instruments. There's Trimpin, he built the thing at the EMP, that crazy guitar sculpture. And his sculptures are fantastic, they're beautiful to look at, but they all make sound. But he used to call them kinetic sculptures. Anyway, what happened with Trimpin was, I'm going back to Boie's touch screens. Slightly out of order here, just let you read that. The history of it, again, is that because Max wanted to do things for himself, that's what motivated him, he made a small effort to kind of accommodate my interest, but mainly he went in his own direction. He was much more interested in conducting. So this is a pretty good conducting device, but I wanted to think something that would, you know, detect really fast things like this, and so I started working on other versions of the radiodrum. Okay, so here's a little movie that was taken at Karma. It's very short.
Improvements in technology are revolutionizing all fields that use computers, including computer music. One group that's leading the way is called Karma, which stands for the Computer Center for Research in Music and Acoustics. And tonight, we meet some musicians and composers who are embracing these changes.
So this is the original one. See, it looks like a tea tray. It's white formica and wood around the edges. So underneath that is the same big PC board with the backgammon, and then there's the antennas. That's the antenna, and then the sticks are transmitting. And here we're using a Yamaha disc clavier. As I was saying, since this is a virtual instrument, it has to talk to something to make it go. So we started connecting it to a piano, David Jaffe and I, and it was fun.
This is Andrew Schloss, but he's not a pianist, he's a percussionist.
Now, I mean, you might say, why in the world would you try to play a piano with a couple of drumsticks? It's insane. But the reason it worked for us musically is that, there's a lot of piano literature, and it's very pianistic by definition, if it's good, that is. That is, it's designed, usually, if you're a pianist, or if you're actually any instrumental player, you can tell right away if the composer knew how to play your instrument. I can say that as a percussionist, equally true if you're a trumpet player, a pianist, whatever. You can right away tell that the person who composed it just put notes, and they might be brilliant notes, but they're not thinking of the player. So that's the way you should compose for the piano. But the problem that we felt aesthetically was that, you know, the piano had been beaten to death. And so by making this bizarre interface between a percussion instrument and a piano, we could completely go outside of the normal way of thinking about the piano. And so that's what we did. Now notice that I didn't have to touch it to play it. I was playing super fast. I just crashed the piano. I was playing too many notes at a time. The piano, the fuse blew on the piano. we used to carry a box. Before they had the little switch, we had actual fuses. We'd carry a box full of them every time we went to a rehearsal because it burned so many up. Anyway, the point is that the radio drum, because it's three-dimensional, you don't have to touch it to make a sound. And that, of course, was a major difference between the radio drum and anything else. Now we have the Kinect, we have all these 3D sensors. But the radio drum is still, I'm still using it because the Kinect isn't fast enough to do the stuff that I want to do.
Oh, I should have done that.
He's playing an instrument called the radio drum, which in turn controls the piano.
Basically, this is still a percussion instrument, although it's a modern percussion instrument. You might call it a virtual percussion instrument in the sense that the drum, this radio drum itself, doesn't make any sound at all. And in almost all cases, I do things that would be considered superhuman for a normal pianist with only 10 fingers. Even a mutated pianist with 15 fingers wouldn't be able to do it.
And you know, it wasn't just our aesthetic, it's also embarrassing. When we first started doing this, we were at Banff, which is a in Alberta, Canada, and it's a very high-end sort of musicians' country club, so to speak. It's a very fancy place, but you can go there and get grants to work there. Anyway, we met many pianists, virtuoso pianists, and if we did something that they could do, they'd look at us and go, "What the fuck are you doing? I can play that. You know why? What are you using computers for? Just give me the music. I'll play it." And, you know, at first we sort of were in opposition, and then we realized this was absolutely the right approach. Why use a computer to do something a human can do? It's one thing if you're stacking boxes in a factory, sure. But if you're doing art, I don't want to do what a person can do. I want to do something different, something, you know, in its own aesthetic. So that was kind of what pushed us into working in this way.
One of a number of new instruments being developed at Stanford University.
For example, what you just saw is like 10 trills at the same time. I think about how many fingers you need to do a trill and figure out how many trills are possible, you know. So you can do 10 trills on the piano. That is a completely different sound, and that's what we were looking for.
It's Computer Center for Research in Music and Acoustics.
That's called Cooper's Last Direction, by the way. Tower.
Karma, for sure.
That's Max. See, now, you can see right away he's got I used to call him the Bozo the Clown Sticks. Not to his face, because it would have been insulting, but, you know, they did look funny with those big colored balls on the end. And with all due respect to Max, who, you know, legendary figure, he had his own way of thinking about it. But you can see that his conducting algorithm, or a paradigm, I should say, is a great paradigm, and it goes all the way back to the groove system that he did with Bell Labs back in the 60s with Dick Moore, when Dick was there. And it makes a lot of sense to be able to conduct with this thing. But you can see that he's not interested in these really fast kind of percussive gestures.
Radio drum was a predecessor to another instrument, the radio baton, also invented by Professor Max Mathews, who many regard as the father of computer music. Do you like the title, Father of Computer Music?
Now, I'm very proud of that, whether it's true or not. But in 1957, I did write the first programs that could play music on a computer. Now, they couldn't do live performance for a very simple reason, and that was that in those days, computers, even biggest computers, were too slow, so that typically it would take 10 minutes for a computer to calculate 1 minute of music. So the first slice is a pickup.
But Pentium processors inside Matthew's computer now can calculate and play music in real time. The radio receivers in a flat drum-like surface track the positions of the batons, each equipped with their own.
Now you can see this is another version of the drum, way simpler than the one that Boie made with this beautiful printed circuit. Max just used tin foil or aluminum foil or whatever. He was into, you know, making things simple. And this worked, but its position sensing wasn't great. Very cheap to make.
A radio transmitter.
This baton is my conductor's baton where I'm beating time. And it will follow my tempo. If I beat fast, it will go fast. If I beat slow, it will go slow. And I think you should use more expression on this string. Let me stop.
Coordination is a must, but you don't need to know anything about music. Mathew says that frees the performer to concentrate more on the sounds and not on the technique.
So Max had this idea called the sequential drum, which we use a lot in different ways. But the idea was that, you know, most people, and this is good for beginners, but it also can be good for advanced players. And that the idea is that you let the computer do some of the work. So, for example, you can just put in a sequence if you have a bunch of notes you want someone to play. So that now, obviously, a good pianist or whatever doesn't have to worry about that. They've practiced for years and years, and they can play what you put in front of them. But in certain ways, you might want to have, either for beginners or for certain context, some kind of system where some of it is in memory so that it goes through without ever making a mistake, and the rest of it you have control over, some kind of expressive control. So that was Max's idea.
It's really meant to be an expressive way of playing music. The performer can devote all of her attention to the expression of the music and not worry about getting the notes right.
Clearly, just about anybody can pick up the batons and play, but the instrument is mostly used by universities and professional musicians. Joanne Carey is a composer for the radio baton.
I think these pieces were somewhat inspired by the possibilities in the synthesizers I'm using and in the radio baton.
That's Jen Channing's wife, Maureen Channing.
It's a different set of movements than the chamberlains, but it does.
That was a yet different version of the drum. See, that one was white, like a white box. So there are many, many versions of the drum. I don't have every version myself anymore, but.
Do you know how many were made?
Not, well, of each version?
No, I don't think a total of all the
total variants. Of all the versions? Oh, maybe just 50?
Okay, well,
but I'm in the process, at the end of my talk, I'm going to tell you what I'm about to do. But when I played, just because I am a percussionist, people would come up to me and say, can I get one of those? And I'd have to say, well, not really. They were put together by Tom Oberheim of Oberheim Synthesizers.
Really?
Tom and Max worked together on this. And they kept iterating that, for example, one version that I don't know if you'll see, they got rid of the wires. who decided the wires were a pain in the ass. They are a pain in the ass. On the other hand, if you get rid of the wires, you need batteries or something in the stick. And being a percussionist, I didn't want to give that up, so I still have wires. This instrument, by the way, is one of a kind. There's only one of these. I'll get to that later. So anyway, yeah, there's probably about between 50 and 100 of all the versions out there.
This allow you to get far out.
David Jaffe composes for the radio drum. He says what's important is to keep the human element in computer music.
The problem with computers and technology these days is it's possible to have somebody sitting up on stage typing into a computer and all this music is coming out and you have no idea what's going on or what he's doing or anything. So in the piece, we're very careful to begin with clear relationship and kind of bring the audience with us and say, well, he really is playing this in the early days of computer music.
That's Julie Smith, who's the guru of digital signal processing.
We found out very quickly that we had a problem with repetition.
Associate Professor Julia Smith is working with a team developing the Synth Builder, a device they say will be the next generation synthesizer.
Instead of just recording the output of an instrument, instead of recording the sound it makes, we, in a sense, record the physical properties of the instrument. No two notes are ever exactly alike. They're like snowflakes. There's always some little tiny deviation, microscopic deviations, associated with exactly how you played it, exactly when you played it, and if the note was ringing, when you replayed it, then you'll get a lot of different effects.
But Smith says, for him and others at Karma, the goal is to go beyond the latest and fastest technology. It all boils down to providing musicians with more creative freedom.
As with all kinds of music, I think really the medium isn't that important. What's really important is the idea, the musical idea, and of course there's interaction with the medium, but you have to come with your own personality.
All the music you've just heard was performed by Karma musicians, and during the rest of the program, we'll highlight more of their work as we toss to our breaks. If you're interested in learning more, click on the TV Tonight page on our website at site.com. We'll be back right after this.
So that was done about 20 years ago. What's interesting is what Julius was talking about is still true. That is, people still use samples, you know, they sound really good, but they don't, you know, they don't change. They don't reflect subtle changes. And so, anyway, so Randy has worked on a lot in physical modeling. You might know about Kaivo, which is one of Randy's programs, it's very cool, that does physical modeling. But it's for me, it's really important because I get so sick of hearing the same sound. If I map this, and I've done it for hours and hours and hours, I map this to different percussion sounds, for example, and I just get sick of the sounds, and there have to be ways of getting around that. One way of getting around it is this robotic idea, which Trimpin, I got into it through Trimpin, those kinetic sculptures I was talking about earlier. Basically, if you're playing a physical thing that hits something or blows wind through something, then you get that magical variety that you can never get the exact same sound twice. Every time you do it, it's going to sound slightly different. So I started getting interested in not in synthesis or sampling, which is what I started doing, but in playing actual acoustic instruments with an electronic instrument. And it seems weird, like, why would you want to do that? In some ways. Well, one thing is, let's say you have a drum set, and you know, you can play like this, right, as anyone would. But what if your cymbal was on the other side of the concert hall? What if you could reach over and play that cymbal over there? And it might sound trivial, but it's absolutely amazing what you can do with space. If you spread your instruments out, but you have control, so I can put the cymbal over in the other corner over here, I can put, you know, like timpani over there, and I can lay it out on the surface. And it makes a whole new dimension of music. So the other problem is, you know, loudspeakers. People have been complaining about loudspeakers forever. Martin Feldman used to say, loudspeakers, tombstones. Anyway, so I'm going to go fast. So there are problems with robotic music and MIDI. The worst problem, if you think about a piano, there's no way around this, but when a human being plays a piano, if they're playing a quiet note, they move slowly. That's how you make a quiet note. But if they were playing a constant sequence of constant rate of speed, but they had accents, And what you'd see them do is go like this, right, for the loud ones, and like this for the other ones, and it comes out perfect. And that's because we're animals, you know? Squirrels know how to anticipate the car, hopefully. We have this whole physical setup in our brain to know how to anticipate and so on and so forth. So when you're playing a piano, if you see that you're going to be playing a quiet note, you start early. And you do this absolutely effortlessly, especially if you've trained, but even if you haven't. You know, if I just try to go like this, whoops. That's a pretty regular triplet, and I'm doing it without thinking. It's just part of my physiology. And so it's hard to do that with machines because machines aren't psychic. So if you send a note out, one of the concepts of MIDI is kind of problematic. You can't send something saying, I'm about to play a note. There's no such thing. Mm-hmm. You send a note out, and then it goes to the solenoid. So if you're playing an instrument that has solenoids and you're trying to do dynamics, every time you play a quiet note, it's going to be late. So it's what I would call a dynamically dependent latency. And we know that latency, like in a church organ, is okay if it's constant. Humans can deal with constant delay. But if the latency is irregular, it's not good. I just have to play this funny movie. This is old, but I think it's amazing even now to see the robot looks so human, but then when it falls, it looks very much like a machine. I mean, it's pretty amazing, isn't it? How we as animals respond to that. You know, it really seems human until it falls. Anyway, so this is the first time I was able to do something with Trimpin. He just a million different inventions. One of his things was he made these beautiful German player pianos German toy pianos into player pianos. So this is in his studio here in Seattle, but the first time I got to plug into Trimpin's installation was at an event at Jack Straw. And what happened was Trimpin, for years and years and years, had been storing his music the way Nancarrow stored it on piano rolls. Trimpin would store it in a little MIDI storage device that you could buy, and it was totally reliable. He didn't even use computers. He would just put the MIDI sequence into the box, put it inside the gallery, and you know, hidden from view. And then his beautiful sculpture would play all the music that he wanted it to play. And I saw the obvious opportunity. All I had to do was plug my radio drum in where he had his memory, and I could play live. And it took me a while to convince him because this is his world, you know. I think he felt maybe at first that I was slightly invading it, but now he's really into it. So I connected my radio drum and I played all 9 of his player pianos at once. Sometimes like this. I'm going to move on because, you know, there's not enough time. So this is yet another version of the radio drum. This, I glued some black foam on the surface because the event detection, by the way, is done in software. You know, there's no piezo or anything here that knows anything. It's just the position of the stick. But what that allows you to do, another thing for me that was really important in contemporary music, is you can play silently like this. Now, if you have a piezo, like a drum pad, you know, those drum sets, it sounds like this, right? And yes, it'll play a loud sound, but you can almost always hear this because there's always a tiny delay between that and the actual sound. It's okay for, you know, if you're in a rock band maybe, but if you're playing really quietly, the idea is that you're just detecting a change of direction here. There's nothing going on other than that. So so this drum was version whatever. And this is one of his player pianos. There were 9 of them spread around the room. So that was the first time I did it. And since then, I've been doing a lot of pieces with Trimpin. This, I'll just play a little bit of it. This is, David wrote this piece for a whole kind of ensemble plus me as a soloist. And it was so hard to get all the instruments together that I decided to make a solo version of it. And so this is just a little bit of that. But this is at a place called the Western Front in Vancouver. And that's a disco version. So here I'm actually playing, so to speak, but I can then change it so that I'm not actually touching it, as you see. So what's between the drum and the piano is software, of course. I'm just going to let it run until I stop hitting it, which I think is soon.
Swing.
Yeah, we hung it from the ceiling just for fun, but it was a pain in the ass. Okay, here we go. So now I'm not actually touching it now. I'm playing in space. And you can see it can blow a fuse pretty easily.
And you're using a foot switch to change
the kind of foot voice? Pedals to go from one cue to another. Now this is another sculpture that Trimpin made. It's 8 computer-controlled turntables. And he came to Victoria as a guest artist, and I had so much fun. Randy worked on this too. Basically, I found 8 copies of a Fonda, Jane Fonda exercise.
Oh,
and
no.
I put all 8 copies of the record on, you know, all the turntables. And then I controlled the turntables from the radio drum. This is yet another version of the drum where the foam was on the sticks and the antenna is just uncovered. So I'll just play a little bit of this. Every physical situation is different. I wish you could hear this full volume.
What's the turntable doing?
It's turning faster, slower, forward, backward.
It's on a servo?
Yeah. It's very simple. It's a potter's wheel with a wheel. Mm. But you can see that something as simple as that, just spinning a turntable forward and backward, when you have control over it in this physical way, you can go into another world.
Are all the turntables doing the same thing?
They all have the same record on them, but I'm controlling them differently.
Each individual?
Sometimes, yeah. All right. Now, at EarCon, when I met when I met Miller Puckett and got introduced to Max, the language Max, I was really interested in jazz, and I went to a jazz club and I met this great pianist named Jeff Gardner, and that was when I first started trying to use this super weird instrument to do more sort of normal music. So we had a trio. This is a great bass player from the Middle East. I don't remember, I think from Morocco or from, I don't know where he's from, but he's a great player and I don't remember his name. But we played quite a bit at EarCon at night, and if Les had found us, he probably would have thrown us out, but he never came at night. And then I started trying to play Cuban music, which is the biggest challenge of all, because the Cubans are, you know, incredible drummers. And this is on the web, and I didn't bother to get a password, so I'm going to skip it, but because I have some other examples that are sort of similar. But Chucho Valdez, for those of you who don't know, is one of the world's greatest pianists, and it was incredible honor and also very intimidating to play with him, because he plays with all the best percussionists in Cuba, and they are the best in the world, in my opinion. So I started doing that, and then I met the next generation of Cuban pianists, Hilario Duran, and started a trio with Irene Mitri on violin, and we did concerts around all over the place. And these concerts were kind of a mixture of Cuban music and electronic music. I'll play some examples. And this is Randy and me in Cuba. Just play a little bit of this. Remember this performance?
Oh, yeah.
This is called Uni. And Randy is, you weren't, were you playing the Tactex pad or a keyboard?
I think it was keyboard.
Maybe a keyboard, yeah. So this is, sure, I'll just play a little bit of it. Just to say a word about it. So here we're generating sound and visuals at the same time. Not a new idea, but it's fun to do. You can, in other words, you can use your ears to improvise, and you can use your eyes, or you can use both. Sometimes I would just look at the screen and I would improvise off of the visuals. This will be really hard to hear without sound system. We did this stuff, you know, visually was not so easy to do. We were using Anodyne, I think. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is a Karpla Strong algorithm that was invented by mistake, or discovered by mistake, at Stanford by an electrical engineer. Stop it just because I have more stuff. When's the last time you watched that, Randy? Okay, so here's the Afro-Cuban thing with the Lario instead of Chicho. This is a piece that I commissioned from David, so it's kind of semi-composed. It has cadenzas and stuff, and it incorporates Afro-Cuban jazz. This was at a town hall called Underground Economy. And again, this obviously sounds different through a sound system, I can tell you that. So here I'm playing samples. But they're good samples. They sound real. Discovered that Trippin had been wanting to collaborate with Henry Brandt, who's a wonderful composer who died just when they were starting to talk about working together. And David and I both studied with Henry Brandt. So we approached Charles Amarkanian, who runs the Other Minds Festival, and we finally got everything to work together and got a grant to do a new piece for two string quartets and me playing Trippin's sculptures. Actually, they were Henry Brandt's instruments that he gave to David when he died, and then Trippin turned them into robotics. So I'm not going to go through all the details, but it's antiphonal. The eight string players are spread out throughout the hall. We did play this at the chapel last March, And I know Randy was there, but maybe no one else. Anyone else there? So this is Trimpin supervising putting, hanging the chimes from the ceiling. So this is another example where the sculpture and the instrument get blurred. So it's kind of an installation with these chimes hanging from the ceiling of the concert hall. But I had control over the chimes from here. And I could map, so if I went like this with my stick, the sound would move across the ceiling over the audience's head, which is cool. This is what the music looks like. For those of you who know something about notation, you can see that the string parts are eight, basically two string quartets. They're written out pretty much exactly, although they do have some interesting tempo improvisations of tempos of drifting. But my part is, on this particular page, is written out, but most of my part is improvised, which I'll show you later. This is my part. Now, this part is the whole score, so one page is only about 10 measures. And this part is just me, so it's obviously way more condensed. So what you see here might last for 4 minutes or something. I'm going to play this in a few minutes to show you how it works. So here's David and Trimpin setting up. But rather than, again, because we're short on time, I think I have a condensed version of this. Yeah. So this is just a couple of things that I'll demonstrate how I did it. All these sounds are real sounds. My left hand is doing a fade in. A crescendo. So there are the string players.
Is there a conductor?
No, so it took a lot of practice. So I'm moving my hand up as a cue, but also to fade out the piano. So those chimes are hanging above the others. That was not a very good attempt. The xylophone has little solenoids under each Bach key. This is a chime solo, which is kind of quiet. It's very beautiful to hear it overhead. Thank you. it's pretty deafening. I'm getting the entire piano excited. And then it fades out very slowly. And the string players fade in over the decaying piano. Anyway, okay, so let's see what time it is. Because I want to do an actual demo. Okay, well, there's a million different pieces I've done. This is another installation of Trimpin's where we ripped a bunch of pianos apart, and then he put solenoids on the pianos, and I again control the pianos from the radio drum. Just play. This is very quiet, but we cheated. Basically, we had her with the pitch pipe off because she doesn't have perfect pitch, and I knew which of the solenoids I was going to excite. It has a little magnet in it, which makes this string oscillate without an attack. So she started singing the note before I started playing it. And it's a nice effect, but I don't know if you'll be able to hear it. So we had those spinner things, but most of these sounds are being made like a, what do they call that thing that excites a string?
Ebow?
Yeah, like an ebow, yeah. It's Trimpin's version of an ebow.
What's going on with the green one?
The green one just tilts very slowly, and it has balls in it that roll. I had control over all the different pianos. So I'm going to skip ahead because I... Weird, just scraping, banging. Keep moving here. Mm-hmm. This is Trimpin's version of a disco here, 88 solenoids. And we're just testing it to see how it compares to the disco here, and the answer is it's faster, but the dynamics are worse. And this is a piece that I did using we have a friend at CalArts named Ajay Kapoor, and he built these little drum things. So I'll just play a little bit of this. So those are samples that you hear now, samples of woodblocks. But they're connected also to the drums, and you can hear the drum playing in unison sometimes. So you can play rhythmically without actually hitting the drum.
How do you do? Is there a tempo that's...
I'll show you.
Okay. Yeah.
Let me skip ahead. Now here, this is kind of interesting because this is using the physical thing to hit the drum, but then I have a microphone on the drum. And I'm doing signal processing on the acoustic sound of the drum, and it's like pulling taffy, so that I can change the sound after it happens.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how well you can hear those glisses. But. All right, and this is improvising with a viola, so I'll just play a tiny bit of this, where I have a whole bunch of frame drums controlled on the radio drum. Just a free improvisation. And I'm picking up her signal and then processing it. Okay, so now, what am I doing next? So let me just go back. I said there's only one of these. What happened was, Bob Boie retired, moved to Vermont, and was interested in how I was using the drum, I think was sympathetic that I couldn't get Max to kind of really listen to me too much. So anyway, he came out of retirement and built this one-of-a-kind drum for free on in his farm in Vermont, and he gave it to me, and I loved it, and I did a bunch of concerts, and then when I got the gig at the Other Minds Festival, they made me sign a contract saying that I had a backup instrument, and I signed it because I thought I would have a backup instrument, and I now had three or four failures building a copy of this instrument, even though I have all of the schematics. And you know, one of the frustrating experiences with the guy that Randy knows, and he's really good, he helped Randy with the sound plane, but this is, for some reason, I don't know why, it's just all analog. There's nothing digital in here at all. It's completely analog, including even how it communicates with the computer, because Boie didn't want to deal with FireWire or Ethernet or USB. So what happens is we send the analog signal into the computer, but because some of you know that the A to D in a computer or in an audio interface, they don't go down to DC, they don't go down to 0 hertz, they go down to maybe 10 hertz. And when you do stuff like this, this is like less than 1 hertz. So you can't detect it. So what we do is we send a sinusoid out of the computer into this, which multiplies it in analog by the gesture signal. And then you digitize that, and then you demodulate it. So simple amplitude modulation. Anyway, this is future-proof because it doesn't have any digital connections with anything. It's all analog. But it's a pain in the ass, plus I only have one, so if I drop it, you know, I'm screwed. So, after three attempts and a lot of money that I hired people, I also went to SenMat and asked Adrian Freed to help me, but Adrian has now retired from SenMat after Wessel died. The point is, I can't seem to copy this even though I have every schematic that Boie used. So, I have a friend who does software radio. Software radio is this. It's not a new thing, it's new to me, but you know, DC to daylight, you basically just digitize everything in the spectrum and then you use software and you don't need any special circuits at all you need is software. So why not make a drum that way? So I've got a graduate student now working on this and I hope it works because I'm so tired of not having a backup instrument. So basically, you know, you send out the signal through the sticks and it's received by the antenna and the whole thing is software. That's research support for all this stuff. I work in Canada, so I don't have to worry about Donald Trump. I sort of don't. I mean, if he blows up the world, then I do have to worry about him. But as far as funding goes, it's a little easier in Canada. And if you want to come visit, we have a vintage bootleg. Moog in the East Coast, bootleg in the West Coast. So this instrument's from the early 70s. And I almost got rid of it when I arrived in Victoria. I got rid of all the tape machines. I just couldn't deal with them anymore. And I almost got rid of this, but then this guy started faxing me from LA, offering me money. And that's when I thought, maybe I should keep it. So I'm super glad I kept it. So now let me eject and let me show you, give a short demo of how this thing works. So let's pretend I'm performing this piece, The Seven Wonders, and shouldn't have put that, let's see what's it called. I'm just going to show you the. Oh, I shouldn't have done that. Is it going to ask me? No. So I just want to show you the part, which is down here somewhere. Then I'm going to demonstrate it for you. I'm going to go through the cues. So now I'm going to start at the beginning, I guess I have to go back to Max to make sure it's all working properly. This is my sort of front, you know, user interface. So when I hit this, it advances the cue. This is my foot pedal. So I don't have to use the computer at all. I just concentrate on playing. And so this is a glockenspiel part, which is written here. And it's a sequential drum. It's this part right here. If I back up and play the cue again, you'll see that, yeah. So I'm going to back up and go forward. And this cue now is programmed in the computer, the glock part. And then as soon as I get to the end of that, as soon as I get to the end of that, it automatically plays this, and I have control over the speed. And here, the xylophone and the piano independently being controlled. And then when I go to the next cue, I can't see what cue I'm in. Should be on Q3, yeah, okay. So now I'm playing. I don't have a cursor. The third from the bottom. Now I can control the background sounds while I'm playing the melody. Sorry, that was the, I told you the wrong thing. That was the top line of the thing. Now I can fade in. So that played all 88 notes of the piano in random order. That's hard to get a pianist to do at top speed. Now let me just go really quickly so I can see sort of how this works. So the next cue is mapped to the different parts, registers of the piano, and when I go to the next cue, so what I get is a palette to improvise. These are 7. 6. And there's chimes here, which is the cue to the violins. And then, what's happening here? Oh, yeah. This is kind of interesting. It's exponential decay of speed and duration. So it depends on how hard I hit it and where I hit it. And they eventually decay. And I can stop them with this hand one by one. Like that. Or I can fade them out. With my left hand, I can fade them out, which is also a cue. And then another cue. Now here, so the x-axis is mapped to chromatic, and the z-axis is mapped to loudness. And now about speed, let's see, I have another key. I can't do it here because I'll show you another cue. I have another enable pedal that I don't know which pedal it is, so I'm using a different instrument, but when I hold the enable pedal down and then hit with my other hand, it changes the speed, so that's how I get it. Right now it's all the same speed. Okay, now I can do it. So watch this. That's super fast. That's slow. And anything in between.
Is it hard to remember what all the
Yeah, it's hard to remember, but you know, you play it enough times, you just know. So this is really beautiful because, as I say, the chimes are hanging from the ceiling. and there's a mapping that corresponds. So what's interesting is when I play the accents, I'm not actually hitting them, I'm just making the distance smaller. Sort of like a drum set, except instead of hitting drums, I'm hitting like these clusters on the piano. That cue when everything's playing at once. And the bass, you can't hear it, but it rings for a really long time. This is interesting. So this is a melody being played on the piano and the xylophone, and they're synchronized, or just slightly out of synchrony. But then when I move, they get more and more out of sync as I move across. They become fragmented. It's the same melody. And then they converge as I go up here. So let's see. So just to show you, what I should do, and I haven't done, is use this to control Randy's physical modeling. But just as an example, if I use a resonator, I can find it. What this is it's just a click, it's an impulse that is going through a bank of resonators. So it's a mess, this hash. But the click is this. That's really neat. That might do it. Just one second, I should be able to get this to work. So then I can change the sound because I'm basically changing the filter or the filter parameters. But I have this interesting hack where if I play at the same time with the two sticks, then it changes the parameters of the filter and it sounds like. This is the patch that I'm going to use for the software radio. So it uses a UDP receive, and it's it's going to be an Ethernet instrument. I just did this in the last day or so. Something very simple that I'm forgetting.
They start trying to nicely throw us out in about 15 minutes or something. Okay. So great if there's a little time for.
Yeah. Okay. I will stop there because it might take me 15 minutes to fix it. So, are there any questions?
That was great.
Thank you. Yeah, that was really interesting. What's your take on this?
Take on what?
Like modern music. What do you listen to outside of?
You know, it's funny. I mean, I guess jazz is my favorite style of music, and Afro-Cuban jazz is what I really love. But I you know, I also listen to, you know, people like Ligeti or, but not that much. I mean, I listen to that when I'm in the right mood. I don't listen to music all the time like some people. So, you know, I'm very specific about what I listen to. But, and I like, you know, I like pop music. I love Stevie Wonder and, you know, I love all the bands that I listened to when I was in high school, like, you know, the Love and Spoonful and groups like that.
Sure.
But, but the kind of music I play myself is in this sort of weird realm from experimental into sort of jazz. But it's definitely not mainstream. So as far as the, if you're interested in the instrument, you can find me through Randy. I'm going to, as soon as I get the software radio working, which I think will be in the next month, you could build one of these things for $50. I mean, this is all off-the-shelf stuff. So, I say one word about this idea of capacitance between the stick and the surface. When Randy was in Victoria, it seemed that you could make a really elegant instrument by having two surfaces that are separated by a little bit of rubber, so you could push down and get some nice physical feeling. So Randy designed and built this instrument called the sound plane, which I think most of you know about, but it's beautiful. And it feels so different from a glass screen because you can push into it, and that's what makes it different, I think. But it is a capacitive instrument like this. It doesn't have the problem I have, because it doesn't ever, you never, you know, the two surfaces that are being interacted are only, how many millimeters apart of it?
Yeah, like quarter inch.
Quarter inch at the most. And so it's very accurate until you get maybe 6 inches, it starts to get worse with this instrument. So,
what's going on in the sticks? I mean, you have to do something special to them, right?
Yeah, basically, these are regular drumsticks. So drilling the hole is the hardest part. And then you just run the cut through and put a little brass ball at the end.
Hmm.
And that's all you have to do. They're easy to make the sticks. Except
for you have a crazy long drill bit.
Yes, I do. And I have lots of sticks that I threw in the garbage and it didn't work. I mean, you can, you know, if you're not making a really nice stick, you can just put it along the side and put some shrink stuff. So, yeah, I mean, you know, for rock and roll and stuff, I don't think people are going to be that interested in these wires. But if I can make a really inexpensive version of it that's just as good as this, I think people will. A lot of people will be interested, I think. We'll see.
Wires are okay if it's...
If it's
kind of just accessible.
Yeah, if it's something you can do and maybe build yourself. And the thing is, you can see how, you know, this thing is an open book. I mean, you can do whatever you want with it. You can play drums like you would with a drum pad. And the nice thing is that if you are playing drums, you can map continuous changes of timbre across a surface. There are some drum pads that do that now, finally, after 30 years, but there were none when I started this. And then, you know, as I say, I would switch to another instrument, but because there's plenty of connect, we have this big space, it's nice. There's plenty of drum pads with the piezo, but there's nothing that combines the 3D with the... With the whack detection. You could use two different techniques. You could use piezo for hitting and then connect for the other part, but somehow that doesn't appeal to me, even though it probably worked.
So what are the dimensions that are coming out of it?
So what comes out of this literally is signal strength to the four corners, and then you it's called the moment of capacitance. It's basically the ratio between them, which tells you this, and the ratio between these, which tells you this. So essentially, you get X, Y, and Z, but not directly. You have to calculate X, Y, and Z.
And then there's the fourth signal. It's like the difference.
Yeah.
Is that for the hit?
There's four signals. Okay. So there's what happens is that you get the corner strength, and then from that you calculate X, Y, and then Z is just the signal strength. It's the sum of the four corners. But when you're moving towards the surface, then you get DZ, which is the velocity. And he built that into this, so you get an analog signal of DZ. With the software radio, you're not going to get that, so you have to calculate it, which, you know, you should be able to. If the sampling rate's high, you should be able to do that. So, because you want the second derivative, which is acceleration, and then you want to use some, you know, it's a well-known, there's tons of literature on how you detect this kind of, but, you know, you have the usual problem of, like, let's say I put it on here, and it's super sensitive, and there's a tiny bit of noise like this. That's interesting. Maybe that's why it stopped. Well, anyway, these balls that we don't see right now for some reason, You can see them jittering just a tiny bit. And if you put it on the surface, oh, that was you. Sorry, I hope I didn't say anything too awful.
No.
Okay, good. It was frustrating. But,
yeah.
You know, by
it's
the way.
It's nice to hear you try two other times.
I did, and good people, so I don't get it. Anyway, if you put it on the surface and it's jittering just a tiny bit, well, eventually you're going to get, you know, spurious hits. So the subtlety is to make it ignore the tiny noise, but still be super sensitive. And that's, you know, a signal processing problem.
Did you have problems in performances when people started bringing cell phones?
I've had all kinds of problems. Not with that. I've had problems with just electromagnetic RF. Oh, my God. Like, I did a concert in New York in this old church called the Judson Church, I think it's called. It's right off of Washington Square, you know, NYU. It's a famous place for contemporary music and dance. And so I really wanted to play there. And I plugged this thing in, and it was just like the noise was everywhere. And I was going to have to cancel the concert. And then I asked the guy who worked there if he had a 200-foot extension cord, and he did, and we plugged it in on the second floor, and it was fine.
Really?
Yeah.
Just noise in the ACs?
Yeah. Another time I was doing a concert in Vancouver, and Ajay had a big robotic solenoid thing right next to it, and that was hopeless.
Mm.
But if I turned it off, it worked great. But it took me like half an hour to figure out where it was coming from. So the advantage of having software radio is that you can move the signal around. You know, you can find some quiet place. This thing just has fixed frequencies.
What do you mean you can move the signal?
So in other words, because it's software radio, you can look around.
You can select the spectrum you want.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Just the little piece of spectrum that's quiet. And,
oh, I see.
Yeah,
yeah.
And, you know,
you create the domain, right? So rather than the domain being fixed, whatever frequency
no,
you're
I get it
is,
now.
You can set
yeah.
a different channel.
On the slot
yeah.
right here. Right. So that should be an advantage. You could even automatically have it look around.
Mm-hmm.
Have you tried to play with like intentional interference?
I haven't. I've been so freaked out by it, unintentional.
Well, like especially with the SDR thing, if you could like play with adding interference to like 2.4 gigahertz Wi-Fi spectrum, because
uh-huh.
there's always like you know
right.
all the Wi-Fi networks around. And
stuff. Right, right. There's all kinds of cool things you could do once I get it working. Also, you could network millions of them with Ethernet. That'd be kind
mm-hmm.
of fun.
Yeah, I was gonna ask if you played with like. Duet of Radiodrum before or anything?
Not really, because nobody else had any.
So how many of the different models do you have?
So this is the one I'm using now, the only one of that. And then I have a couple of older ones, but you know they're kind of I'm not really using them. If this broke, I would go back and dust them off. But, so
did you say this one was kind of tweaked for you especially?
Well, I mean, basically Boie made it, and you know. He did it by hand, and it's the only one he made. So he just sat there and fooled around with it until he got it right.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a master at analog capacitive.
So. What are the other ones missing?
So the other ones, you know, there are two more that have been made. And then, like I said, I brought all the rest of it down to Berkeley and gave it to Adrian, who was dying to do it, and then nothing happened. But so the problem is that either they're noisy or like the one that you made, it was close, but somehow it just wasn't, like, there was some kind of problem. In
like, the third dimension wasn't there. It was
yeah.
way off.
And I don't know why. And, you know, like, you're not alone, so, yeah.
Well, I think it would just take a lot of calibration because
yeah.
it's pure analog.
Yeah,
and
right.
analog synths have, like, built-in
yeah, yeah.
calibration
right.
that even there still right. needs to be tuned
yeah, yeah.
by an expert, so...
Yeah, and that's, you know, he had been doing it for his entire career. So even though he gave us the schematics, there were probably a lot of little tweaks that weren't in there.
Well, plus, if you remember, like, some of the radio transmitting parts,
right.
like when they baked the circuit boards,
right.
the parts crack.
Right, yeah.
So that's not very reassuring.
Yeah. No, it's not. Yeah.
When was this one made?
This one was made about, let's see, how long ago did we work together? Maybe 6 years ago. So this is probably made about 9 years ago, I'm guessing.
Is there like a difference in the process, like versus S&T versus through hole or something?
No, it's we built the exact same circuit board,
really?
The same design, but not all the parts were available still.
Mm.
Yeah, Boie used a lot of old stuff
mm.
that he was used to. That was another problem. And you know, I went back to him. If I'd gone back to him right away, he probably would have fixed it. But by the time after all my goofing around, when I went back to him, he was really retired.
Mm.
He was in his 80s. So he was just feeding his goats and stuff like that. Yeah.
Are Are the schematics for, the schematics for the SDR one that you're working on are going to come out?
Yeah,
are the schematics for the earlier models available?
The schematic for this is available. I can send it to you.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Sure. Just give me your email. Yeah. You know, a lot of this stuff was patented twice, actually. First, Bell Labs. That's really old. But then, when Paul Allen started Interval Corporation, I don't know if you guys remember Interval. Lots of really smart people worked at Interval. Boie didn't work there, but Max worked there. So he made another set of patents on whatever they hadn't patented the first time at Interval, which I guess were owned by Paul Allen, I guess. But they've all expired, too. So it's open, you know, territory, really. You don't have to worry about it. But I think I'm going to do what Randy did. You basically told people if they want to make it, here's how you do it, right? And then, but you make the really good ones.
Yeah.
And that's sort of
it's sort of open source model, yeah.
That's what I'm going to do.
You bring the benefit of your expertise to the table.
Yeah. And there's a bit of scaling too, like the open source one is just 2x2 grid, but the sound planning is 64x8,
Get
a lot more
resolution. Yeah, the
if you're very ambitious, you could try and build a loop.
Yes,
you
could.
Well, it's fun to come here. I'm sorry we didn't have audio, but you heard most of it. Just, you know how it is. Frustrating to hear it out of these little
speeches. So you live here, but you teach in Vancouver. How does that work?
Well, I ride my bike down to Pier 69, get on the boat, look out the window, read. It's a nice commute. No cars. I go Tuesday and come back Friday.
Oh, wow.
But I
sorry?
Go
ahead.
I don't have to teach from April to September, so that makes it easier.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any performances scheduled coming up?
Not immediately, but I'll keep you posted. So is there some kind of a mailing list or something?
There's a Google group you get on, and that's the best way we have so far.
What's it called?
I've done
communicating. Seattle, it's Seattle Music Machine Salon. And there's definitely a website you can find by that name that should have an address. The Google group, if you do a little hunting around.
I'll tell you what it is.
Well, thanks very much.
Oh, thanks for coming.
Yeah.
It's nice.
And
yeah, thank you. It's nice to talk to an audience that's really, clued into it. So, thank you.
The website is seattlemusicmachines.org.
Beautiful.
Nice. Mhm. I can't remember if it's with an S or without, so I have to look it up.
Anyway, yeah, thank you.
Thanks so
much.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.